All right. So, hey, can you throw up my first slide? I wanted to go over some stuff from Thunder. I'm going to be talking about models tonight, but I think my first slide is some takeaways from Thunder. You guys remember Thunder? It was about like 2 weeks ago. Okay, I know it seems like it was far away, but here's some of the nuggets that I got from some of the teachers, and I always write these down because they're just like so deep. And Paula White Cain, and that Cain is from Jonathan Cain, who's part of Journey, who I got to drive around. I was really stoked about that. I know it's an 80s thing, I'm sorry, but I was really kind of stoked about it. But Paula White Cain said, she said, do not let delay is not denial and get out of man's opinions. These are things that really kind of stuck in my heart. Clint Brown, is faith is revealing what he has already done. And then some of the morning stuff, Steve Hage said, how I believe is how I behave. Ron Carpenter was, purpose is determined destiny. And I think I got one more takeaway on that. Clint Brown, oh my God, when he just started worshiping in the Lord, it just some deep, deep stuff came out. Because I remember listening to a bunch of his songs when I first got saved. It was pray for our head. Pray for our senior pastor. Pray for the leadership of the church and honor, honor, honor. You know, we just don't know how to honor sometimes our leaders, and we need to do that. And matter of fact, on this point, Pastor Dick, if you're watching, thank you very much, Pastor Adam. It's always a privilege to cover the pulpit, and I hope I do my best tonight. And I just love our pastors, and I want to honor them. And then Bishop Rick Hawkins, words frame worlds. Say that with me. Words frame worlds. Whatever is not God sent can be God used. Now, these were just some of the things that were said about 2 weeks ago during Thunder. And how much, you know, as time goes by, sometimes we can lose our thunder. Okay? Now, would you agree that Thunder was special? Yes. That it was anointed and appointed? Yes. That it was powerful and life-changing? Yes. That you were refreshed? Yes. I mean, the yeses are kind of going down. If that holds true, then what are your next steps? Where do you go from that? What do you do now? How do you keep the fire? I got Josiah up here because I wanted to show you that it's been 2 months since that one trip we went on, but he's still staying on fire because he was doing and taking steps. If the message was so powerful during Thunder and it was so life-changing that your heart and mind were just transformed and then you have to do something about it. You can't just say it was an event, it was a time, the hoop and holler's over, and then I kind of go back into my life. I don't believe that the hoop and holler's over. I believe that God is doing something, and I believe that he's transformed us. I think something shifted in the supernatural. Something happened at this church, and it's not about going back, it's about going forward. Can I get an amen from that? So my scripture tonight, as we talk about models, is Romans 12:2. Romans 12:2, and I think we got it up here. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I did it in another translation because I always like to break it down. Pastor Paul, we do this with journaling. I'll use a New King James Bible. I'm using NIV this year for my journaling, and this is NLT, which is New Living Translation. It says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. If we went through Thunder and all that good revelation causes us not to change, then we're wasting our time. It says, then you will learn to know God's will for you. I don't want anyone else's will for my life except God's will. Can I get an amen from that? That transformation is to let God work in my life. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Perfect. And we have one more translation. Oh, the Message Bible. Woo, this always breaks down. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit in without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God and you will be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it, unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down. Come on, somebody. All you have to do is just watch any type of media, and it's dragging you down. Dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. Can I just say models? Models have to change us. The things that happen at Thunder have to change us. When we look at that word in Romans 12, the transforming, it's the word metamorphosis. It's a process to change and to change your society, to change your world, to change your mindset. Because if not, you'll return to the old ways. The seeds will be stolen by the birds of the air and all the cares of the world. And that can happen over time if you don't activate. Okay, it's been 2 weeks since Thunder. And how many have went through some stuff? How many have like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm going through this? Stuff just by changing your life. And it's almost getting you to the point that you're forgetting the revelation that we received 2 weeks ago. Okay, James says this. He says, be doers of the word and not hearers, only deceiving yourself. You see, if you believe that the words that were given are transforming and you do nothing about it, you're deceiving yourself. You have to change, or you will. It's almost like if I don't change, I will lose, and the enemy has actually stolen the seeds that were given to me. Talking about models, I can remember my brother's here, my older brother, even though he looks younger, but praise the Lord. He must have got those genes. I remember when we were younger, you know, we didn't have all the video games and all that. And we used to do models, and he was always good at the models. He remember that one model you did with the ship and the bottle, the Constitution. It was really detailed. And one of my first models was a model of the flying tiger. I think we have there it is. You know, so just just manly, like a manly model. But you know, how many of you know when you're building a model, there's directions, and there's steps. And you don't want to get out of the steps because each step is building on top of another. So you don't want to go here because the foundational stuff is here. And so, of course, me being young and impatient, even to this day, my wife will say, but anyway, you got to take those steps. And I have a couple more pictures of what this model is. Look at that detail. That's a model. That's someone with a brush and going down in there and fine details. And I have one more. Yeah, that's not my model from back in the day. I just want you to know that. Okay, that's how it was supposed to look when you follow directions. But when you don't follow directions, just stuff's just jacked up. It's just all over the place. I think I had decals all over, paint was wrong, and I, you know, just screwed up a bunch of stuff. Here's what Webster says about models. Usually a small copy of something. A set of ideas, numbers that describe the past, present, or future state of something. An example of an imitation. You know, when I think of models, I think of the Old Testament. And in the Old Testament, there are some models for us to follow. One would be Exodus 20, which would give us the Ten Commandments. I mean, you know, the Ten Commandments are still good today. I know it's Old Testament, but it is still good foundational teaching. It basically shows the life of a believer, the do's and the don'ts, the values and the principles, a model of God, what was expected of his people, what God expected of his people, and a behavior that was needed. And so that used to be displayed in schools, and so you take that out of schools, and what's changing? The behavior in school, the principles in school, the values in school have changed, the do's and don'ts. It's like no one knows what's wrong, and it goes back to the prophetic word, which in the last days, right will be wrong and wrong will be right. And so we're in a stage of confusion because we got off the model. We got off the model. There's another model of the ark, and the ark was made a specific way and had specific dimensions and certain material because God knew it was going to be a way to transport his people. The exact measurements help to get the ark to a place where it would withstand storms, waters, and waves. Okay, it was a shelter and a protection for God's people to carry the lineage of God. The ark was tested because we know that the number 40, 40 days and 40 nights in the storm is a number of testing. This is out in Genesis 6, okay? And so in that, this is a model that God shows us. But as we get away from God's models, then we start to struggle. Now, that's Old Testament. You say, well, Pastor, that model stuff, that's Old Testament. What about New Testament? Well, in the New Testament, we have some models too. And we have it in Matthew 6, verse 18 through 13. This is the model prayer. So I'm going to go there in my Bible. If you have your Bible, go ahead. Go to Matthew 6, verses 8 through 13. And it says, therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forget our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil, the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Now, we're not supposed to take that prayer like some religious facets do and pray that exact word. What he's saying is a model of how you are to pray. It's the subject areas of what you're to pray in. You don't have to say it verbatim, but you want to cover the areas. Okay, so when we look at this model prayer, it says, when you pray, pray in the what? The name of Jesus, because Jesus has power. Okay, we don't pray on our own accord. We pray in the name of Jesus. I know this is kind of basic, but it goes back to where I'm going from models, because we kind of get off the models. And then the next line is the purpose. We're praying the purpose, not only in heaven, but on earth. We want a little bit of heaven on earth. We know that heaven is just not going to, that heaven is not just going to be all transported down to earth, but we need a little bit of heaven. We need a little bit of the kingdom on earth. And then it talks about the area that is very, very heavy and usually on everybody's mind. It's provision. All right, people struggle with giving because they struggle with provision. They don't know where their provision's coming from. But when they understand provision comes from the Lord, it doesn't come from a job. It doesn't come in what I do. It comes from the Lord. And God always takes care of his people. Can I get an amen to that? So this is a model on how we're supposed to pray. We're supposed to have to pray for these things to open up. If you're a business owner, pray for the ideas, pray for the strategies that God will give you, that he'll give you ideas so that you can provide provision, not just for yourself, but for the house of God. You see, in Purpose-Driven Life, the first day from Rick Warren's book, it's not about you. So when you understand that provision is not about you, you start taking care of others, start taking care of the kingdom of God, and watch how God will take care of your house. That's what Pastor always says this. He says, take care of the house of God, and he'll take care of your house. And this is in the model prayer, so we pray for provision. We pray for protection, we pray for power, and we pray for praise in our life. This is a model. This is a model. And so we need to make sure in the model we're going step by step, that we're doing what we need to do. Or we need to be patient in the model. That's a word for someone right now, because you're about to make a decision. Be patient in the model. God's doing something, but he's not doing it as fast as you want him to. But don't move out of the model. He has something for you. Someone say model. God has a model for us, and he wants us to follow those models. There's great things in the models of God. They keep us in boundaries. They keep us in a safe place. He even has a model for restoring a brother in church. Pastor Paul, this is one of your favorite ones, Matthew 18. Matthew 18, 15, if you can just go ahead and go there. Are you still with me? I feel kind of mellow today, like I need to just teach. So usually I'm really, 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 really just excited up here. And I am excited, but I just want to make sure that you're getting something tonight with the word of God. Is that okay with you? Okay, someone say amen. Amen. All right, here we go. It says, Matthew 18, 15. Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. You know what? Sometimes we need to make sure that we're forgiving our brothers in church. We have a thing of Jubilee saying that I'm growing in my love with God to grow in my love with others. So the maturity of growing in your love with God is when someone offends you in the church, that you go to them and you make peace with them. And if you can't, you get other people involved. Why? Because the church needs to be in unity. The world will know us by the way we love each other. So if we struggle, if we say we love God, but we can't love each other, that's what the world sees. So we can't be hypocrites in the house of God. We have to make sure that our values, our ethics, and our culture is matching with the things of God. Hey, you know what? That was Old Testament. We showed some New Testament. We showed models. Do you know that there's a model in our church of how to grow in Christ? I think I have an illustration. My guys will know it because I kind of go over it a lot. It's called a life journey. The life journey. You know, it starts with salvation, then it goes to water baptism, and someone announced, Pastor Margaret, you announced water baptism. You know what? Water baptism is so important in your walk with Christ. You know, it says in Mark 16, and I tell you this story because there was a man in our church a long time ago when I was preaching in Livermore. He had cancer and he was terminally ill. And he said, Pastor, I need to be water baptized. And I go, well, you've been in the church for a long time? He goes, no, but Pastor, reread Mark 16. And he says, it says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every nation. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. So he really felt like I need to be baptized to be saved. Even though he made confessions, he knew he had to make amends with his maker because he knew that he was going home with the Lord. We water baptized him in a pool. About 2 weeks later, he passed away and went home to the Lord. Water baptism is important. And so we have this life journey. We have salvation, water baptism, foundation classes, all going on, being filled with the Holy Spirit, encounters. We just had a marriage encounter with those that two couple of Nicholas and Emerald, and they got transformed, Pastor. They got transformed, and now they're doing some advertising to you, and they're saying, hey, get into marriage ministry. Hey, men, don't wait. Don't wait until someone steals your mate. Get in there now for you to prevent those things. And then we have the encounters. Then we have serving. Come on, folks. We need people serving. And then you have attending a life group and being and leading a life group. This is the life, this is the model for Jubilee Christian Center. How many of you saw that before? I mean, this is the first time. This is the first time. Just raise your hand. This is the first time you've seen it. This is where we're trying to go with our people here at church. We have a model of soap, right? We had a model of soap. Can you put that up? And we have a model. So scripture, observation, application, prayer. This is how we do daily devotionals. Why is it so important to do daily devotionals? Because if you don't get into the word of God, you'll start believing the lies that are going around you. And they're half lies, right? There's stuff to cause you to doubt because you're not in the truth. And the truth does what? It sets you free. Now, I love what Pastor Paul says about devotionals, because Pastor Paul kind of taught me devotionals back in the day, and I've been doing them. He says, what happens when you miss a meal? Yeah, you get hungry, right? You don't die, miss one or two meals, right? But you get hungry. That's the way it is with journals. Don't get on yourself if you miss a journal one day. Just get hungry. Get hungry to get into the Word of God so that the things that you're hoping for, the things that you're believing, when you start talking to people, you'll feed them truth and not just emotions. We have another model at this church of our vision, mission, and values, and I don't have it up there. But our vision at Jubilee Christian Center is experiencing God and loving people. And I tell this to my leadership all the time. Why is it so important to know the vision, mission, and values of this church? Well, it's so important because if you don't know the vision, mission, and values of our church, which are on our website, www.jubilee.org, then you don't know if you're creating or destroying a culture because you don't know our values. And so if you're part of this church, if you're sitting here today and you don't know that, please go on our website, find out what we're about. You know, when people come and they visit us, that's one of the first things they do. They find out, what is this church about? And so if a new visitor comes into our church and our value is supposed to be a welcoming atmosphere, and a new person comes in and we give them an attitude, are we creating culture? Are we breaking culture? See, we're breaking it. And that's not going to transform anyone. So those are models. Those are models that we have up. So you have to understand our models for what we're trying to do to get people to go from one place to another, how we do our devotionals, how we have our vision, mission, and values. And of course, we have the model of once a month, we have water baptism. We have communion. We have baby dedication. Those are models. Those are models. Those are models because they're opportunities. Do you know when we have baby dedication that we get about 200 guests a month when we do baby dedication? So that's why we need to know our culture. So when someone says, hey, I raised my hands the very first time I'm here, we got to make them feel welcome. Because if we don't make them feel welcome, then we're not following our model. Are we getting it? Is it kind of making sense here? I know this is kind of like a Foundations 101, but we need to understand this because we'll never complete the Great Commission without understanding the vision, mission, and values of our church. You know, there's a model of marriage. There's a model of marriage where if you want a Jubilee pastor to marry you, you have to attend a pre-marriage class, you have to go through some classes, we'd like you to go through a marriage encounter, all for the reason to safeguard your marriage and divorce-proof it before you get into trouble. You see, we don't want you to get in trouble first and then come to us. We want to give you the information and tools to stay out of trouble so you don't have to go through some of the stuff that our folks have went through. You know, back in 1985, I had a dream, and it was pretty cool. It was like I was in the service, and I loved riding motorcycles. Can you put that motorcycle? This was my dream bike in 1985, okay? And so in that, what I did is I didn't follow the model of honoring my wife. And I bought a bike. Yeah, she's nodding her head. I bought a bike, and I forgot to tell her that I was buying a bike. So it just showed up in the parking lot. How do you think that worked out for me? I had one of my buddies who brought it home, and my wife goes, man, your wife's mean, man. So she just gave him the eyes. I didn't follow what I should have did in marriage, Pastor Paul. I didn't talk and come in to agreement. So since 1985, 1986, when I was hoping for this bike, I've had like three or four bikes. But they never hang around. They always leave. And I just believe I haven't followed a model. But you know what? How many of you know that God knows the desires of your heart? Yeah. And so, you know, this last thunder was tough. Thunder, I mean, I know you all enjoyed it, but thunder was tough for us. I mean, it was some long days. So I hope you prayed for us because, you know, by like day three, we're like, oh, you know, we're just. But it was a good time. But that Saturday, we had a couple hours off. And I told my wife, hey, let's do something that turns my crank, what makes you happy. And for her, it's shopping, right, women? Shopping. So and for me, it's like, what turns my crank is fishing and motorcycles. It'll put a smile on my face. I don't think about anything. It's almost like an escapism for me. And so we went and I test drove this bike, and it was cool. And then my wife said a statement that I couldn't believe. But see, because I'm following the model of marriage. I'm doing what I need to do. I pray over my wife. We're going on 30 years of marriage. Praise the Lord. So thank you, sweetheart, for. And so she goes, when are you going to stop test driving and buy one? Okay, now hold on. No, don't get too happy. Okay. Pastor Paul, come on, Pastor Paul. That was in the moment. So I took 3 days of praise and fasting, because a lot of things can happen in 3 days, correct? Right? You know, like God overcame the world in 3 days, and I stole the keys and gave us. So I waited 3 days. And I said, you said a statement that kind of bothered me. You said this, but did you mean that? And can I have that defined? And she said, yeah, go ahead. And I go, well, you just made my day. And my wife gave me the blessing to go ahead and buy something. And go ahead, guys, put it up there. Because God gives you the desires of your heart when you follow the model, okay? And I didn't follow the model. Stuff was just leaving all over the place. I didn't do it right. And there's a way to do certain things in marriage and come into agreement and make sure that it fits in your budget and your account and that you can do things. And then God opens the doors. So there's models that he wants us to follow because he doesn't want us to go to the left or to the right too much. He wants us to stay in this lane that will help us. There's a model for church growth. Did you know that? Come with me to Acts 2. Acts 2. This is one of my favorite scriptures in the New Testament because it's all about small groups. How many are in small groups? How many are not in small groups? How many are small group leaders? Small group leaders? Okay. Now, one more time. How many are not in the group? No, obviously now they know where I'm going. So I'm going, small group leaders, please look at those hands and go after them after service tonight. But here's what it says. It says in Acts 2:42, it says this. It says, then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day, see, they were baptized. They were baptized, so they got a revelation. They were baptized. They were baptized. That's why it's so important to be baptized, water baptized, fire baptized, because that brings revelation to you. And that day, about 3,000 were added to the church, and they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. This is small groups, and this is the model how to run a small group. They had the doctrine, they had fellowship, they had communion, breaking of bread and regular food, and they had prayers. And that's how the church grew. Okay, that's how the church grew. The church grows when you open up your house, when you open up a place like, hey, we're gonna be at Starbucks, and you do these four components. You have doctrine, which is the word of God. You have fellowship, because it you can't be too top heavy on the word of God. People have to see that you're walking this thing out. That's why leaders, when you're going through something tough, don't stop your life group. Show your life group how you get through it, because they need to see that. If you only do things that are good in front of them, then they think they can't duplicate that. They have to see a leader going through some stuff, and how you get through it sets a model for them to follow. Can I get an amen from somebody? The model is set there for small groups, and you go through stuff, but then the church grows. The church grows. Day one, purpose-driven life. Someone say, it's not about me. See, when it's not about you, you'll do these things that God's telling you to do because it's the model that he's showing you. My wife and I have devoted our lives to the ministry and to the things of God because God has blessed us tremendously, and the journey has been it's been like nothing else in the world. We've had good times, we've had bad times, but man, how many of you know that when you're in the will of God, it doesn't matter if you're in a cell with chains on, you'll be singing praises to the Lord. That's a good place to clap. Go ahead. All right, so he has a model for giving too, right? This is a good model. I know some of you don't wanna hear it, but it's a good model. Give 10, you keep 90. That's good. That's a good model. I mean, it could be the other way around, right? He gets 90, you get 10. I mean, that's a good model. And then it comes back to you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So you're blessed to be a blessing because that's the Abrahamic blessing. But you have to understand that you don't hold on to the blessing. You give the blessing away, because if you hold on to the blessing and you start hoarding the things that God's given you, and he's given it to you for you to bless others. So if you understand that principle, if you understand that model, then you'll understand every provision, everything that he gives you in life is not yours. So even this ride that I got, I was really worn with it because I was like, Lord, I've had some rides in the past and I just need to make sure it's used for your glory. So I'm believing that souls are going to get saved. I'm believing that we're going to make some contacts, Aaron. Now we're going to go out there and we're going to change the world through motorcycles. Guys, if you were like, I wanted to get a motorcycle in the future, and your wife's right there, that was a good time to say amen. All right, just telling you. Okay, I got a couple more minutes here. Are you still with me? We're talking about models. Remember I gave you the definition of what a model was according to Webster? It was something imitated. I looked up model, and I went to the antonym of model, and I was dumbfounded by what I saw, because it says the opposite of model is failed, inadequate, inferior, average, normal, ordinary, typical, mediocre, second class. I started this teaching tonight on what do you do after thunder? As God has a model for your life to be prosperous and do great things, the evil one also has a model for you to be average, normal, ordinary, typical, mediocre, second class. We all know that the evil one comes to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. John 10:10. He wants you to forget about everything that happened 2 weeks ago. He wants you to forget all those words and all those impartations that have happened in your life for you to go back to what you knew. And those aren't the models that he has for us. Those are not the models. What happens when you run out of the model, though? You go, okay, Pastor, you showed me the models. You showed some of the Old Testament models. You showed some of the New Testament models. You showed some of the models that are in church. You told me that, yeah, the evil one is trying to get us to follow his model because he has a counter model to what God's model is. But what happens when I run out of the model? I'm glad you asked. Luke 15. We're going to end off with this. This is the parable of lost things. Oh my God, I'm not gonna read all those verses. Okay, it is the prodigal son. It is the prodigal son. And let me just point out a couple things in this story because it's a story of what happens when you run out of the model. Well, this is how you get restored. And if you know how to get restored and you know the models, then I'm telling you, you got the game plan for success. So in the prodigal son, he was entrusted with an inheritance. Okay, God gave him something. God's given you something. If you didn't know it, God's given you something. He's given you a calling. He's given you certain talents. He's given you provision to do something. Then he asks you to go out and do something. In this case, the prodigal failed the test, but I love what Michael Pitts says. He says, a faith that is not tested cannot be trusted. So God puts you through and allows certain things to happen for you to get these tests to see where your faith is. Because if it's not tested, it can't be trusted. And so people are stuck in the same place because they never take the test. And God's telling you to take the test. It's all right to fail because he has a model for restoration. See, you're afraid of failing, but God said he didn't give you a spirit of fear, but a power and love and a sound mind. Because you got to know the model of restoration. And then it says when the things went south, it said that the prodigal son came to himself. You see, that's when the meat and potatoes, that's when the rubber meets the road, because you remember those things you prayed about. You remember those messages in church. You remember the models that Pastor Randy was talking about. And then you dig into those things. So what happened is he had to squander the gift or the inheritance. Then he went to a place where he reflected and came to himself. Then he repented, and then he returned. This is the model of restoration, because only then can you have reconciliation, restoration, and celebration. You see, you can't have those other things if you don't know this model. See, these models are so important because God wants us to elevate. He wants us to go forward. He doesn't want us to go back. We want to enjoy the fruit of the labors, but we're not understanding the models he's given us. We're not understanding the models in this church. We're not understanding what pastor is trying to do in this valley. We are trying to get souls saved because he who wins souls is what? Wise. It's all about soul winning. Well, pastor, I don't want to take a class. Rick Warren, purpose-driven life, day one. It's not about pastor, I don't have that kind of attitude to go talk to people. It's not about, I don't feel like going to church tonight. It's not about, because you got to show up, right? You got to show up. I don't want to talk to that homeless man or give him a dollar. I'm just going to ignore him. Love God, love people, love the unchurched. They're people too. They're people too. Someone say model. If you want transformation after thunder, look at the models. Follow the directions and watch the end results be his and not yours. It's never been about us, folks. Y'all, here's the alternative. Go back to the old ways and nothing happens and church comes a routine and your life never changes and the promises, you're going, well, how come you're not delivering God on the promises? Well, sometimes some of the promises of God are conditional. Do this and he'll do that. But we want God to always move first, and he doesn't always do that because he's testing our faith and where we're at. The alternative is like the opposites of the word model, which were inferior, average, normal, ordinary, typical, mediocre. You know what? We're in the world, but we're not of the world, folks. He knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. He knows the very hairs on your head, the exact count. Now, I know we're talking about models, but understand, the Creator knows what you need. When you get out of the old model, the world, and get into his model, you'll understand the best is yet to come. He says it, folks, in Jeremiah. For I know the thoughts that I have towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. I don't know about you, folks, but I need God's models in my life. I need God's models. And you know what? Remember these two scriptures when you run out of the models. Because when you run out of the model, it's a place called grace. He says in 2 Corinthians 12:9, he says, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I would rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. In Ephesians 2:8-9, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Here's my last model to show you when you mess up and you go, man, I've been in church for a long time. Man, pastor, you're preaching to me. I know I should get involved. I just don't get involved. I know I should talk to that person. When all else fails, this is almost like break the glass and look at this model, because this covers it all. Go ahead, guys. It's the cross. It's the cross. It's the cross. That's my final word tonight. You know, we just did a memorial service for a man who doubted himself if he was saved, but I know he is because of the cross. I know he is because of grace. We don't always do what we're called to do. We don't always do it right. Man, if you do it in love, you do it with grace, and you do it by the cross, these are all the models that God wants you to have. Stand up with me, church. Cindy, can we get up on the keyboard here? Because I want to do something that I've never done before here. Give it up to him, folks. Give it up to him. Thank you, Lord. Come on. If we're going to praise him, let's praise him in this house. Not a long message, not too deep of a message, just a simple message of remembering the models, because we want our lives to be transformed. Father, we thank you for tonight. Holy Spirit, we just pray that you would just enter this place right now and just confirm and affirm the words that were given. I know it's speaking to someone. It's speaking to someone to start serving this house. It's speaking to someone to start opening up a life group. It's speaking to someone to just get activated. If you've been in this house for any amount of years, do not let the gold that has been driven out there and that has been shot out through thunder in the bay and everything that's happening, there's so much momentum going on that it would not be wasted, Father God. We pray for transformation power right now in the name of Jesus. Church, can you just lift our hands a little high? Right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that there would be an open atmosphere. Can we pray in tongues right now? I know we normally don't do that, but if you got the prayer language, can we pray? And can we just see something happen tonight? I believe lives are being changed. Come on, church, pray with me. I believe there's someone in the crowd tonight that's been showing up at church but doesn't really know you. But I'm saying tonight is your night. Do not let something pass, because none of us know what tomorrow holds. And we need the promise of salvation. Father, it'd be who of me if not to go to this place. If that is you, if you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, if you've been showing up at church but you just don't know, or if you need to rededicate your life to the Lord tonight, saying, Lord, I haven't followed the model, but I want the model, which is the cross, because the cross redeems us back to God. It redeems us, folks. If that's you, I just need you to just wave your hand. Just wave your hand a little there. I know we got all hands raised up right now, but if that's you, I'm just looking for the one. If there's one I need to pray for tonight, if there's one that I just need to, that needs to rededicate that life right now, I got you. See, church, we never know when we come to church. We never know. We think that everyone has it down, and God looks from the inside out, not the outside in. So would you repeat this with me right now, church? Father, I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. Come into my life. Change my ways. From this day forward, I choose to serve you. Change me. Mold me. Transform me into what you want me to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hold on, we're not done yet. We have some time. I know it's a school night, but we have some time. If tonight's message was for you, like, I feel like I'm losing the fire. I feel like I'm just getting into the mold. I feel like I'm getting into the regular routine. At church is just becoming a task. It's hard to show up. Reading my Bible is very tough. It seems like I'm distracted and things are taking me off. I'm really not on the model that God wants me to for the fast track. I didn't even know about some of the stuff at church that's going on. And I really don't even know the vision of this house. But you've been here for a couple years. Let's pray for some fire. If that's you, if you need transformation in your life right now, in any one of those areas that we spoke about, just raise your hand right now, because I believe that God's power is going to drop in you. I believe that something's going to happen. If that's you, just raise your hand right now. Church, there's hands going up. Can we pray right now? In the name of Jesus, Lord, I pray that this last quarter for 2016 would not be something of routine. That, Father God, that your power, your dunamis power that we pray, would enter their lives, Father. Would you give them revelation? Would you show them how to get into the Word of God, Father? Lord, may you bring sisters and brothers to simplify the process. May they ask their pastors, Father God. May they ask for help. Lord God, we bind fear and we bind pride right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Man, I don't know about you folks, but I just feel like, a rest in the air. I'm gonna dismiss you. Let me bless you before we go. It's always an honor to serve you. That's what we do. I'm not up here for me. I'm here to serve you. I'm here to bring out the best in you and teach you. And so are the other pastors here. And all these classes that we have, we're trying to help you, because we want to change the world one soul at a time. Father, I thank you for the Wednesday night crowd. They're awesome. They're dedicated. I pray that you would bless them. I pray that the rest of the week, they would touch a soul, that they would invite someone to church, that they would pray for someone in their workplace, Father God. And Lord God, I plead the blood of Jesus over them. I pray no weapon formed against them will prosper. Give them visions and dreams, Father God. Holy Spirit, baptize them with new revelation and new power to break the holds and the chains of the evil one. And Lord God, I just thank you for them. May they stay faithful and loyal unto you. In Jesus' mighty name.